Hi friends, welcome to my channel Ask2Shamik. So in this video I will discuss about the microservice characteristics. So in my previous talk I discussed about why microservice needed at the first place, but in this video I will try to what are the common characteristics of microservices. When you are try to choose the microservices, what the characteristics you need to follow. But before going to the microservice characteristics, first I will discuss about a few common misconceptions about the microservices, because when I talk to in my juniors or certain friends who are just new to the microservices arena, and I discussed with them, they have some common misconception around the microservices, and I try to jot it down all those misconceptions so we can discuss about these things and rectify our mistakes. So the first misconception about the microservices is breaking a monolith into small services and exposing it as a REST endpoint is called a microservices. So because this is an well-known definition and you can find it all over the internet, so this common definitions that breaking a monolith into small services, independent services, it's called a microservices. But this definitions is kind of an vague definition. So when you are saying the services, what kind of services it is, how big that services it is, how you can choose that which services can be extracted from a monolith and then can be independently deployed into a system. So means if you have an utility program, if you segregate that utility program and expose this as an endpoint, deploy them as an services, individual services, is that called a microservice breaking? So this is not the case. To when you are need to break a monolith into multiple small services, there are good amount of architecting is needed and good amount of the domain driven knowledge is required here, because when you want to break a small services, you need to know first, what are the bounded context of the different services? What are the relations between the different services? What are the business capabilities of those services? Then, based on the common business capabilities, you need to create a context map, and then you should break a service into small services. So, this is kind of a big process, and how to do it I will discuss it in my later videos. But as of now, the definition, the small services and exposing as an endpoint is called microservices, is just keep in mind it is not so easy, and it is not like that if you do the cookie cluttering and create several services and you have create a good microservices architecture. That is not okay. And the second misconception I found is like that Spring Boot application projects is in microservices. So yeah, what means this is around most of the juniors cases, they thought that they learn small Spring Boot and that means they know this microservices, because Spring Boot is kind work on and conception over convention. So the and by a blink of an eyes you can create an web architecture projects, and on top of Spring Boot there is a distribution called Spring Cloud which provides that microservice component. So by Spring Boot and Spring Cloud you can easily build a microservices architecture, but it does not mean a Spring Boot projects is a microservices. So it Spring Cloud offers some common or come utility components of microservices, some essential components of microservices, and within some annotations you can plug in those components in your architecture and you can build a microservice architecture easily. But that does not mean that if someone using a Spring Boot projects, that means that is a microservice projects. Okay, another third misconceptions about the microservices is that microservice communications only done through the REST API, because again this is comes from the juniors, and the things is like that. When juniors are coding, they have seen the all the example in the net or something like that. They have to call a REST API, and even in they are going to interview, interviewer asks the question on the REST APIs, means when they are coming to a microservice level interview, they tested their knowledge about the REST API. That's why they had an idea is like that. If a microservices project, that means we need to know the REST API very well, and REST API is the only communication medium between the microservices. But again, this is an vague thing. So communications can done various way. It can be done synchronous way, it can be done asynchronous way, it can be done in a reactive way, so, and there is lot other tools to do that. In JMS, it's two systems are communicating, it is perfectly fine, we call them as a microservices. Or if you through a reactive programming, if you do the two services are communicating, then we can also call it a microservices. Even though if there is a common event stored there by the event, someone is reacting over the event, also this is a kind of a microservice architecture. So microservice does not mean only the REST API. Okay, so now another thing is each function should be separated as a microservices. So when when you are saying the function, what the function means, suppose there is in some 3-4 lines utility code or 10 lines of an utility code which used in a multiple module, so should you extract that 10 lines codes and deploy it in microservices, that is mean at and microservices is that means that a small function you extract it and deploy it in a container and you call that is an, you create a microservice, is that so? It is not that way. When you are saying that function, if the function is around the business capability, so it should be choose very carefully. So it does not mean that your function should be separate as an microservice. You need to understand what level of functionality it does, because function has a various level. In a broad way, you can see one business capabilities is and one functions, or in a coding's perspective, a small responsibility also called as a function. So what is functions you need to know when you are doing the coding, you are in such a domain, you need to understand what is a unit function is, and then you need to separate that unit functions. Okay, and another thing is that microservice is the best architectures and everyone runs it. So I will also run after the microservices, because monolith is bad. When I talked with some seniors also or juniors also, they said that yes, everyone adopting microservices, that means the monolith is bad, microservice is good. That is not. It is. Will you opt for microservices or not? It is totally based on your organization architecture, organization infrastructure, organization finance. So it is not like that, that always microservices is better and architectures choose over monolith. So now let's move on to the microservice definition. What we mean by a microservices definitions. But if you search in the internet, the main problem is that you get a common microservices definitions, which you can see is microservice is a suite of services where each services can be independently upgradable, removable, and deployable. So this is a well-known definition of the microservices, but unfortunately that definition not has a clear idea what the microservices is, because in this definition there is a lot of why questions are there. So if I ask you a question that why means what are do you mean by the individual services, what do you mean by the independently deployable, upgradable, and removable, how you can break your service into such a part where that one service should not dependent to another service. So there is lot of ifs and ands over there. So there is no concrete definition over microservices. So The next question is that if microservice does not have a crisp definition, then how we can then classify which architecture is microservice? So whatever you have adopted, is it a microservice or not? How you can tell that? So for that, what we need to do is that we need to follow the pioneers companies who have already implemented the microservices. And if we go through their code architecture, their code patterns, we can certainly find out some common characteristics which is distributed over their code, and they all follow that some common characteristics, and we can say if we adopt those characteristics in our code, then our coding should follow that microservice architecture. So those characteristics are very important. So I will discuss about each and every characteristics, and when you are going to add a microservice in your organization, you try to fulfill all the characteristics. I am not saying that this is a hard and fast rule that you have to follow all the characteristics, but it is better to follow the characteristics, then your microservice architecture should be robust and it should be expandable. So let's start with that microservices means what are the different characteristics. So in overall, if I take a holistic view, I can break down microservice character into the 7 parts. So the 7 parts, first it's come the componentizations of a service. Second one is the organize around the business functionalities. Third one is the product not project, which is you build it and you run it principle. And then the smart endpoint dump pipe. Another one is very important, that is decentralization of your code base and database. Now the automated deployment pipelines means the DevOps culture. And last but not the least is the design for failure. So let's go to each and every characteristics in detail so you can understand what these are main characteristics of an microservice, why those are the pillars of microservices. So what we mean by a componentization of a service? The componentizations means you should implement your service in such a way so it can be act as a plug and play. So in your architecture, wherever you need to plug your components, and whenever it required, you can re-architecting your components, maybe in a different language or maybe in a different way. Unless your API does not change, it does not hamper any other services. So it can be a pluggable kind of things. If you in your childhood play about that brick games, you will understand it's very good, because brick architecture is such a like that you put one small brick one up to another and create an architecture. If one part of the architecture is not you are not like, you can just pick out those bricks and create it in another way. So without affecting the whole architecture, the partially you can update your architecture and you can upgrade your service at any of the time. So it doesn't hamper the other services. It is like, think about your mobile phone or your mobile device. Suppose your battery is not working properly, what you will do? You just change your battery and put a new battery over there. If your display is not working or your display is broken, then what you did? You go to the shop, just bring a new display and set it up, and your mobile phone works as same as earlier. So there is no change in the architecture, but that mobile phone is so modular, if you need to upgrade some part, you can do so. Your microservice architecture should be the same. It should be such mobile parts are there, mobility services are there. Whenever you need, you can upgrade, you can replace that service easily without hampering the other things. Now, you can argue with me that in your monolith architecture, what we will do? We do a modular architecture, right? For every certain business capabilities, what you do, you create a multi-module project. And if one module is required to another module, what you do, you create a jar version and import that in another module. So you doing it in a library concept. So it's same as creating a service. Then why where is the difference? But the main difference is that think about that when you are making a jar, it has a certain language, say Java, and your service is also written in Java. And if there is a version mismatch, or your service is in Java 6, your library is in Java 7, you cannot plug in that jar into your services, because if you need to use an upgraded jar, you need to upgrade your whole system. So your system is indirectly coupled with that plugins, that library. Again, your library is kind of a jar, but if you want to change your programming language altogether, for Java, if you want to change it to Python, then your jar version is not work at all in this microservices. So for the dependency purpose, you need to create another service which is written on Python. So this is the main challenges of the library type of things. You cannot so the library is very confined. Library is very confined about the languages. Once the language has been chosen, so you have to stick with that that particular languages. You cannot move out from that languages. But when you are create over a service and communicated over an internet medium, so you have a choice to change your internal language, internal architects. Unless your API definition has been changed, there is other service should not bother about it. That is a true essence of a componentization of a service. So now, the second part is then organized around the business functionalities. What does it mean is like that, if you have a layered architecture, if you have a module architecture, so what the first thing in your mind? If I create a UI layer microservice, if I create a business layer microservice, and if I have a database layer microservice, is that a proper microservice architecture? Or if we randomly choose some business functionality and create a microservice, extract that code and deploy it in container, is that a microservice? No, that is not a true essence of microservice. Microservice should be around a business functionality. What does it mean by the business functionality? Business functionality means a common domain thing. What a particular domain, what are the related functionality that should be logically clubbed into a microservice? So if you consider an employee registration program or employee system, so the employee's finance module should be separate to a HR module, because finance related all operations should be in finance microservices, or all the HR related examples or features are in HR related microservice. So there is a certain difference between the HR operations and your finance operations. You cannot mix and match those. But in your monolithic or layer architecture, what we did for the finance UI, for HR UI, all clubbed in a UI layer, and all the logic, although they are separated by packages, they are in a business layers, and all the database, all the data should remain in a one database that is called Oracle Relational Database. Or if you moved it to a new things, you should put in a NoSQL database. That is not organized on business functionality. What you do is that you put all the things, business, all the aspect of the business in the same area, and you logically divide it. But when a microservice in the place, you need to physically divide your business functionalities, and those business functionalities should have his encapsulated data, and they should communicate with each other through a lightweight medium. So now coming to product, not a project. So if I already talked about my why microservices talk, what I mean by product not project. So current organization structure is like that, when the developer teams develop something, then after some time he will give a KT to support team and hand over to that support team. But these things is not quite goes well with an microservice architecture. But because microservice architecture says that you will work in a confined space, workspace, and you should know where the whereabouts of your projects, and you know, you build this software, so it is your responsibility to run it throughout your life, because you know the best parts of your software and you know what is the weak part of your software, and you know how to fix it quickly. No other than you will be such expertise on your code which is built by your own hand, right? So that is the concept, comes product, not project. So now coming to another things, that is called smart endpoint dump pipe. What I mean by smart endpoint dump pipe is like that, if you see that ESB like architecture, you can see all the routing related stuff, all the splitting related stuff. If there is a data, based on the data format, you need to move your code to another channel, or there is a workflow, all is managed by your channel, means your middleware, where the ESB is so much popular these days, because ESB handles all these smart things together. But what microservice says, microservice is totally reverse than that. It says that your medium should be enough dump, it's only carry the payload, nothing more than that. Whatever the intelligence, that routing logic, that splitting logic, that parsing logic, all comes to your endpoint, not in your pipe. Your pipe should only carry data from one source to another source, that's it. Like the internet works, internet channels are only send the data packets, nothing more than that. But whatever do with the data packets, it will decide by the owned end users, end user systems, the ISP system. This is nothing related with that network or hops by which the data packets are flows. That's why the smart endpoint are dump pipe. Now there is an automated deployment and DevOps. So what does it mean is like that microservice welcomes the DevOps culture. Why it's the DevOps culture? Because when you think about microservice, you think about that multiple independent service will communicate with internet medium. That's why you are working in your code, they are working in their code, you do not know that how it works when integrated. So it needs to be integrated more oftenly with other codes to check that how the whole functionalities is acting. If there is a problem with integration, it should be fail fast. So in a day, you need to deliver your code into your integration platform very oftenly, and you need to do the integration each and every hour to see if there is any problem with the integration. If so, if it is fail fast, then go pinpoint your issue and fix it, again deploy it, again do the integration testing. And it is not possible manually, because every time if you need to do the deployment, you create an INC, your ops team will do the manual deployment. It is not possible for a person to, or group of persons to do that. There should be some automated pipeline system or automated system which says that when you push the code, it runs, then it builds your code, runs the automated unit software and automated unit test cases, and if it is fails, it will send the mail to targeted people. It should be whole things are automated unless you cannot maintain the microservices, because microservices mean communication of the multiple services. So if your infrastructure is not good, not robust, your deployment pipeline is not automated, you cannot achieve microservices, and you will fail. You will feel lot of troubles, and if you feel like that, why I am choosing microservices? Okay, so now the last thing is the design for failure. What does it mean, the design for failure? Is that, as I said, different microservice communicated with different other and thousand of microservices. So there is lots of moving parts, and when it is coming over internet is not controlled by us. So failure is inevitable. So you cannot remove failure from your system, because there is only, if all goes right, then there is one path to success. But if something goes wrong between 20, 30 microservices when communicated together, you will result a failure. So your failure probability is much more than your success probability. So what you need to think about the failure cases scenario, when something goes wrong, how to cope with that, how your system will be react on that. That is the essence of microservice. You need to design for failure, because you know it's come over to the internet, you know your service may be down. So ready about it, do the precautions and check every time your precautions that it is works well or not. So you, that's for that you should care about some microservices monitoring tool, some microservices tracing tools, where you can see where the call goes, which microservices is down, where is the latency, so you can pinpoint, you can identify the errors. And you need to day by day push your service in a test, that how your service reacts when it is failure. That's why that Netflix, Amazon like company, the pioneer company, has so much guards. They generally deliberately creates error in production system and checks how their production reacts. But we cannot think about the productions. We think that production is such a thing that if you something goes wrong, we will be panicked. But they are deliberately creating errors in production system. So they check that how their system works with failure with live data load. So chaos monkey, chaos gorilla, such a tools which randomly abruptly down a data center or down a service, whatever, you do not know, but you need to prepare for that, because it can happen anytime in your production system and you should be ready for that. And if you ready for that, then you can say that your microservice is designed for failure. But if you make the microservices and you will not care about your design for failure, then your microservice will be jeopardized very soon, I can guarantee you. So whenever you choose a microservice, think about the design for failure, otherwise you can, there is no way to success. So these are the some characteristics which is very, very, very important when you are building a microservices. So I hope you like that video, and if you like that video, please subscribe to my channel Ask2Shamik. And I also maintain a blog called javaonfly.blogspot.com. If you will also like that, just go subscribe there, and also subscribe here and put black bell icon so you can get a next notifications of my video. So till then, goodbye.